Welcome to Emil Tokaev podcast. My guest today is Parth Sarkango, who is my great dear friend and consultant in biotech industry. We basically had a dive into the industry from R&D to release to manufacturing and various case studies and aspects. Just the questions I had, because I have very little experience, so it was a great for general understanding of how things work and also for specific advice as far as getting a job in biotech. And in the latter part of the podcast, we discussed Parth's recent trip to India, which he hasn't been to in 6 years, and his experiences and changes he saw since the last time he visited. I had a great time, had a lot of laughs, and I think being close friends really helps make the conversation livelier and I guess find fun in places where I wouldn't expect it to be so. So I hope you enjoy it as much as we did. So tell me more about your life. So, hey Parth.
Hello.
Welcome to the podcast.
Thank you for inviting me. This is great. Excited to be here.
It's a pleasure to have you. You've probably seen me come along the journey
of I have.
Accumulating the equipment that would end up as yes. part of this podcast.
That's true.
Just the beginning of it.
I recognize most of this equipment, and it's nice that we can finally record one of our long conversations that we usually have off record.
Yeah. So, can you give a short introduction to just about your background? Where are you from? Mm-hmm. What did you do? What are you doing now?
Sure.
Yeah.
I am a biomedical engineer. I studied with you in Davis, California at UC Davis.
Great university.
Yeah. I come from India, but I did my high school in Singapore. So I've lived in three countries now. And yeah, I work as a consultant in biotech in San Diego now, which is great.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So basically, after you got your biomedical engineering degree, mm-hmm. you started working in validation, right?
Correct. Yes.
Yeah, consultant.
So in biotech, there is a lot of things that happen in a product development lifecycle. And one small subsection of that is validation. Mm-hmm. A step that most manufacturing companies need to go through to make sure that your manufacturing process is compliant with regulatory requirements. So that is a step that almost every country, which is in biotech, needs to do. So the US also has a validation department, and we comply with regulatory requirements that the FDA has or any other place where the product might be sent out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So basically compliance with the government policy.
Compliant with the government or any other governments that mm-hmm. you might be selling your drugs to or mm-hmm. your products to. Yeah.
What are some of the things that pharmaceutical companies have to, or biomedical have mm-hmm. to oblige with?
The most specific. Important one being sterility. You know, you see these news articles about products or drugs being recalled because there was some contaminant found in them, and that can be a big issue. So one thing that revolves around validation is making sure that your equipment works correctly and performs the job it's supposed to. And then that eventually makes sure that your product is sterile and clean and safe to use.
I can't help but I smile because earlier you said
yeah.
it's been recalled the spray mist that I sprayed, yeah. you know, the face in the yeah. airport. You were scared to use that because...
So Emil, as soon as I came back from the airport, decided to spray me with the mist. And right now, if you can't tell, he has a red eye. So the first thing I saw was a spray and his red eye. And I thought, he's using that spray that's making people go blind right now. And that product was recalled recently. So I
what
immediately
company
backed
was that
out.
Product by?
I have no idea, but I don't remember it anymore. But that was the first thing that came to my mind.
So basically, they didn't comply with something, or they found issues with the batch.
Yeah, there was some contamination problems with the batch, or it could be about the drug itself. I'm not sure. Okay.
So sterility. Mm-hmm. What else?
There would be other things. So like a temperature at which a certain sample would need to be kept at, and that sample is probably stored in a refrigerator. And if that refrigerator doesn't maintain temperature correctly, then your process downstream is affected, and mm-hmm. you might not even realize it if you haven't validated that piece of equipment. So you need to make sure that each and every step in that process, including the equipment where things are stored, filled, manufactured, or tested, are working accurately.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And whose job is it to check and audit that?
Mm-hmm. So there will be auditors coming from everywhere. There could be your own internal auditors to make sure that you're complying with your company's requirements. There would be FDA, which is the Food and Drug Administration mm-hmm. of the US. So any pharmaceutical product that you sell in the United States needs to be approved by the FDA. So they would come to audit. If you're selling your product to Europe, then European authorities would come and audit your facility anywhere, pretty much.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and what job does consulting play in that?
Mm-hmm. Many biotech companies have their own validation departments, but some companies don't, because they just don't have the bandwidth. So they hire consultants who can come in and validate their product line mm-hmm. or their process, and then leave.
Mm-hmm.
So they don't have to hire their own. So we as consultant offer help in those aspects. And validation is just one aspect of things. We could also help in other aspects of the biotech industry.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, what are the things you okay. help with?
Yeah, so the company I work in is Azure Consulting. But Azure also has separate other divisions. They have a clean rooms on demand,
mm-hmm.
which is companies that are small and can't afford to make their own manufacturing facilities can lease facilities from us, already built and qualified
mm-hmm.
and sterile, and they can manufacture their drugs in that facility and then use it for a period of time, and then when they're done, they can give it back to us.
Mm-hmm. So basically, if I started a startup as a pharmaceutical company, it would be easier to just get one of those clean rooms.
Clean rooms, yes. So clean rooms yeah. are also used for manufacturing chips
mm-hmm.
for like NVIDIA or Intel. Those chips manufacturing, they're I think semiconductor manufacturing also is done inside a clean room, and those environments are even more sterile.
Mm.
So they need to meet certain similar regulatory requirements that they have.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
How hard is it to meet those requirements in medical industry?
It can be very tough. So, for example, an operating room inside a hospital, you would think that would be a very clean environment considering mm-hmm. someone's operating on a human body, but that environment is, I think, much, much, much more
contaminated
than a clean room is.
Mm.
There's a particle sampling that's done inside these rooms to make sure that there is no dust, or there's a limited amount of it at least. There's certain requirements of which room this is.
Mm-hmm.
There's different grades of rooms,
mm-hmm.
Like a grade A, B, C, D room. Grade A being the most sterile one, B being slightly less. And based on what's going on inside that room, they classify these rooms accordingly. Typically, a manufacturing room where drugs are actually being made would be a grade A or a grade B, because you want that to be more sterile.
Mm.
Yeah.
Interesting. So what does a day-to-day job look like in consulting Validation.
Yeah. So we write a validation master plan as sort of like a project plan, which is what are we going to do? What are the things that we need to validate? What are the equipment or the processes that we need to look at? And then we start creating a series of documents. What are the user needs? What is the equipment that's going to be used? What is the impact of that equipment? What is the risk of that equipment? What is the price? Where is it coming from? And then when we have categorized all of these aspects, we end up writing a validation protocol to test certain requirements based on their risk. So say the easiest example would be a control temperature unit. So any of your refrigerators, your freezers, your cold rooms, they need to maintain a certain temperature. So that would be a major requirement. How you can test that is you can place temperature probes across the clean room, across the cold room or the refrigerator or the freezer, and you can monitor it for 24 hours or whatever amount of time the user requires it as a test. And then you can check if the temperature deviates within that 24 hours outside your specification limit. And if it doesn't, that means you are saying that this is good to go. Yeah. And then there's more in-depth testing within that.
Yeah. Okay. So a lot of documentation, a lot of checking.
A lot of checking. Yeah. Making sure in every way possible that whatever the user needs is being tested and that we are not having any gaps. Yeah.
Cool. Did you think you would do that when you were doing your degree?
Yes. So surprisingly, this doesn't happen a lot, but a lot of what we studied overarchingly in college in biomedical engineering was what I do in my work. They taught us about validation as a test step, but they taught us about how we write user requirement specifications and what documents that entails, how to do a failure modes and effects analysis. But they didn't get deep into that. I think that's what I learned more on the job.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So what if like a biomedical engineer student was interested in getting into consulting and validation, what are some of the things they should know about it to help them make that decision and learn to be a stronger candidate?
I think with a biomedical engineering degree, you can do a lot of things. You can go into research or you can go into the corporate world. And one of the things in corporate would be, I guess, this path of validation or engineering, which is also a very technical path. But if you're interested in that aspect, if you're interested in working with different clients and keeping things fresh and working on new projects, new equipment, and broadening your horizon in terms of what you work on and what experience you get, working for different companies and relocating and meeting new people, networking, consulting is a great way to get started. Yeah,
just to build a network,
Yeah.
Work for multiple companies, sort of within the company.
Yes. Yeah. So you're still with the same company, but they help you broaden your horizon. You know.
Yeah. So you had you said you had a client who you worked with so closely that it felt like, when that contract was over, it felt like end of a.
That's true. I worked. Employment. Yeah, as soon as I joined my current company, I was on the same project for 2 years, which rarely happens. A typical project in this industry, in our company specifically, would be a couple of months. But a large scale project like this is rare. Our initial plan was to have it for 6 months, and then it just kept getting extended for 2 years because we worked on more and more things. But it felt like I was working for the client company itself.
Are you allowed to talk what project that was?
I don't know.
It's okay.
Yeah. But it was a biotech company. They worked in cell and gene therapy products in San Diego.
Okay.
I don't think I can mention the name of the product, of the company.
No problem.
Yeah.
So for the consulting and validation, in short, what do you think as a career growth down the line where that can go into? What are the potential branches you can go from here?
So you can either super specialize into the engineering aspect of things. You can work on as many pieces of equipment or you can specialize in a certain type of equipment, like utility systems. Every company, every manufacturing facility typically has utilities, which are the gases, you know, your CO2s, nitrogen, your oxygen, steam, etc. And then you have the BAS, which is the building automation system. Some people specialize just in that, that controls the entire building. And those can be routes that people take and specialize in, and they can be very lucrative in the future, especially when you have a lot of experience in it.
Mm-hmm.
Or you can just go into the management side of things, which is what I'm looking to do. I want to get technical experience to be able to understand the business, but I'm more interested in the business development side of things.
Yeah. In the medical industry?
In the biotech industry.
Biotech industry.
Yeah.
Okay. What are the components of biotech industry?
So there would be a quality assurance department that makes sure that all of your work that's being performed by the company is within regulatory requirements and is good for any regulatory inspection. That could be within the company, outside the company, that the company is following their own procedures. There's quality control. They make sure that the product being manufactured is safe. So they test that before it goes out to the public. They're responsible for testing each batch and making sure that the batch that's going to market is good to go. Then there is a manufacturing. They actually make the products that you and I see in the pharmacy or that doctors use in the hospital. Then there would be validation, management, and then typically what every other company has, like an HR and other aspects. And then there's R&D, people who are going into the research route in college, especially people who are doing PhD, they might want to work in a company as a researcher and continue working in the lab. So an R&D route is great for them. And then there's certain smaller divisions like cell bank, which is probably a department within manufacturing. Yeah.
It's very cool. I just thought when you're talking about a product getting to pharmacy, do you know what affects whether you can buy it or you have to get a prescription? What affects that in a product? Like over the counter versus
something that needs to be prescribed.
Yeah.
I think that would be decided by the doctor based on how serious of a drug that is. Typically, therapeutic drugs that are used for cancer treatment, things like that, they're not off the shelf. But like acetaminophen would be something that is a simple enough drug that could be off the shelf. In the manufacturing process, I don't think there's much difference. You're still trying to make sure that the drug is as safe as a drug that's going straight to the doctor. I think that happens after
the manufacturing.
After the product leaves us.
Yeah, I was just curious because in some countries you can get very strong drugs over the counter, and in US, a lot of them are prescribed.
That's true.
And even contact lenses are prescribed versus in other countries you just go by, you just say, this is my prescription.
See, now that makes me think that that's a country requirement, you know,
yeah.
that some countries have regulations over some things that can be available over the counter, and then some countries have regulations that some things are not allowed.
Like antibiotics.
Yeah. So even in India, I think there are some antibiotics that you can get over the counter, but there are some that you can't.
Yeah.
And that definitely does not happen in the US.
Yeah. In US, you can buy antibiotic ointment.
Yeah.
and apply it to your skin.
Right.
Yeah. Which
it's just probably not going to work.
But they can charge you for that if you go to emergency room and that, you had like punctured your foot,
and then you can pay $150.
Wait, just $150?
If you have insurance.
Yeah, I paid like three.
$3,000. That was a sad. That still makes me cry. Still makes me cry.
You know, every time I talk about it, it makes me feel better.
So. You should have just left the needle in the foot. The 4,000.
I didn't have a needle, but okay.
Oh, it was a pin or something.
I just stepped on something and punctured it. On the charger.
Oh, boy. I learned my lesson not to leave chargers on the floor.
Yeah.
Or vacuum them.
Especially up the...
Yes.
The...
the prongs on
yeah the prongs is upwards
yes
yeah.
Ouch.
And always have insurance covering every day, even if you have like a 2-day break between jobs.
The most unlucky.
I was just so excited on my first day in the new job in 2021, and I just jumped off my bed and immediately slipped and really pressed my foot hard into
a charger. Ouch.
And I was worried that it might have hurt my foot too much because the bleeding wouldn't stop like immediately. Mm. And
that's very that must have been.
But it's also foot, because like it's hard for it to stop the bleed because your blood is there, right?
Your blood flows down.
Yeah, so it makes sense. But anyways, back to biotech.
On that colorful note.
Yeah. So biotech has been affected by layoffs. I mean, by inflation and layoffs been happening as well as in tech.
Oh, yes. Almost every single day, I think I read a news article about some proportion of layoff happening in a company somewhere in biotech. I think that's happening across all industries at this point. But it is quite concerning.
Mm. I always thought that pharmaceutical companies and biotech companies had huge profit margins, because the products themselves can cost a lot upfront to research, but very cheap to make once you have it down.
Yeah. Well, if you think about it, most of these biotech companies, you probably hear about the big ones, you know, the Johnson & Johnson, the Pfizer, the Moderna, those ones are the big ones. They can sustain huge economic downturns.
Mm-hmm.
But the smaller companies that probably still need to rely on various other factors cannot sustain a huge economic downturn.
Mm.
And if they rely on another company which isn't doing well, and that cascades down the line and everyone starts getting affected.
Mm-hmm. Do you think biotech also overhired like some companies did during early COVID?
Yes, I think so.
I think
that that happens also based on speculation, you know, how the companies is doing. But I think it's difficult to anticipate that, right? If you don't know what's going to happen in the next 6 months, suddenly. I know companies that have suddenly had issues come up and faced huge problems just because they couldn't anticipate.
Yeah. So a lot of companies offer services to other companies in the biotech industry, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's very common.
Yes.
And I believe that's what happens like at your...
Yeah. Some companies that don't have a manufacturing facility can lease their facilities. It's called clean rooms on demand.
Mm-hmm.
When they need it, they can use it, and then they can leave.
Mm-hmm.
And those clean rooms are generally equipped with certain equipment, so they can use those equipment. And it's an interesting business model. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yeah, it's like.
The company itself doesn't make anything; it leases it out.
Yeah, like rentals.
Rentals.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But technical.
Yeah. Same with the consulting aspect of it. It can rent out the consultants. It can rent out people to do validation, mm-hmm. quality control, quality assurance. So like I'm in the department that does validation. Azure can also send out people to do quality control and quality assurance. And
Mm-hmm. You're located in San Diego. Mm. What are the major hubs for the biotech in the US?
I think the major ones would be San Diego, San Francisco, Boston, Philadelphia.
Mm-hmm.
Four major.
So
there's medical device companies growing in like Minnesota and Atlanta, but those four would be the major ones.
Okay. So ideally, if I wanted to, was a young student.
Would
be one of those areas, ideally.
I think those are the booming ones where a lot of companies have been concentrated around.
Mm-hmm.
Studying in Davis, we used to get quite a lot of companies around the Bay Area that would come for career fairs from
mm-hmm.
Major biotech companies and medical device companies like mm-hmm. Medtronic and Johnson & Johnson, Genentech. Those are all big, big names that are based in San Francisco.
Do you mind sharing the story about Johnson & Johnson?
Which one is that?
That you had an offer.
Oh, yes. So
you
I'm
forgot.
there have been a lot of stories.
You have a lot more stories about Johnson?
Johnson & Johnson holds my top list of the number of times I've applied and been rejected.
Okay, let's clip this and send it over to Johnson & Johnson HR. And, you know, this man is a treasure. Oh, don't miss this opportunity.
That's okay. I think everything happens for a reason.
Yes.
They'll
get around one day.
Yeah, that's not a problem. I'm very happy with where I am. I wouldn't have had the other opportunities if I had that one. So in my junior in college, I got an opportunity. I got selected for a co-op program by Johnson & Johnson,
mm-hmm.
which was a big deal for me. You know, it's obviously one of the...
Co-op meaning?
Co-op is sort of like a one-year job where you're not going to be a student. You're just going to be on the job. It's like a long internship, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
You would need to defer 1 year of school. So instead of graduating in 2020, I would have graduated in 2021.
Mm-hmm.
I applied for it. I interviewed. I got selected. And I even got the position. Unfortunately, what I didn't know that as an international student, I couldn't do that co-op because I needed to be a full-time student. So it was like... the dream was handed to me and then just taken away.
Yeah, it was.
But.
And you even mentioned like to reduce the time you went to talks to try to make it just 6 months or 3 months long.
It was, but it had to be 3 months because other than that, I would have to come back. And their program was designed to be for a year.
Mm. Yeah.
But I think the place I did intern at ended up being a great experience for me. It was a consulting. It was my first introduction to consulting in Atlanta, a company called Secure Biomed Evaluations. And they were a medical device consulting company. And it was a great experience working with them because they were professional in every way and did work so meticulously and so well.
Mm-hmm.
It was a great educational experience. Yeah.
Yeah. What happened that you didn't end up working with them after you graduated? You went to New Jersey.
So when I graduated, the pandemic mm-hmm. started. So you and I both know how hard it was to find jobs during the pandemic.
As a new graduate.
Yeah. I was offered a full-time position when I left the internship. But by the time the pandemic happened, every company had stopped hiring.
So they
rescinded
the offer.
They said they postponed it. But I understand that. That's okay.
It was so annoying. You got the Johnson & Johnson thing canceled because of the legal requirements. And then this thing. Because of unexpected.
Yeah. They did offer it to me like a month or so after I joined the company in New Jersey.
Okay.
Yeah.
But you already said that you won them.
Yes. And then I wanted to see how that one went. But yeah, I understand that the economic downturns affect companies. That's part of the game. You got to play.
Yeah. So what was your experience working in the New Jersey company?
So the New Jersey company was a pharmaceutical company.
Mm-hmm.
It was a great educational experience. The internship was good in terms of the internship was great in terms of understanding how consulting works, and New Jersey pharmaceutical company was great in understanding how validation works. So I think a combination of both of them was good in landing this position. Yeah.
What would you say some of the things that you're hopeful that could have been improved overall?
In the New Jersey one? I think there were... the environment in New Jersey wasn't suited for me. I think it was the peak of the pandemic. It started to get a little gloomy, and I missed the vibrant culture of California.
Yeah.
Yeah. There was a lot happening here. Having worked here for like two years now, I can totally say that the industry is much more connected here. There's networking events and conferences and something or the other that's happening every other week.
Mm-hmm.
And it felt a bit stale for me in New Jersey. So I thought it was good for me to change.
So basically going back to that point of being close to a big hub.
Yes.
Of medical companies where you get to participate in industry events and and grow your network compared to just being in a, not middle of nowhere, but isolated, I guess.
Yeah. And after my internship, I also wanted to explore manufacturing because that was a different side of things. I wanted to see how it is to work for a company, for the client company itself, rather than be a consultant. And I think getting an exposure in both of them made me realize that I wanted to be more as a consultant so that I can work on different clients rather than be committed to one company overall.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now that you had some experience in the industry, what would you say an advice for your younger self or current students or people interested in switching to biomedical or biotech?
Definitely. I would say get some industry experience. I know that's difficult because every entry-level position requires 5 years of experience. I think it's a completely different ballgame when you're studying about something versus working in a company, because no one really knows when you're studying what a quality control department really does, what a manufacturing department really does until you actually go in and witness things and do them. And then you realize maybe this is for you or this is not for you. Getting experience would be the best part. I think theoretical knowledge has its pros, but getting practical knowledge is the way to go.
Mm-hmm. What are some of the things that you learned about the work and things that you found surprising compared to what you expected?
Manufacturing itself was a very different thing from what I anticipated. Graduating as an engineer, I thought being an engineer in a company would involve a lot of problem solving, technical problem solving, but it is a little different. It is more related to a manufacturing operation of a company rather than here's an equipment which is not working, open it up and fix it. And I think my idea of that was very different.
So you thought engineers would problem solve and like issues?
Yeah. I think problem solving is also done in most jobs, but I'm saying technically, you know, like there's an equipment that's malfunctioning and you as an engineer need to fix it, because I specialize in medical devices. So I thought what I was doing was more R&D rather than manufacturing.
Yeah.
Small things that I didn't really know what the company does.
Okay.
Yeah. So, I think, but that's like, that's on the student's part, because if I was, I got to know that once I got more experience in these industries. But it's just my idea of this industry was a little different. Yeah.
So what is manufacturing?
Manufacturing would be to actually make the drugs. So there can be two ways to do that. Either you do automated, where a machine does the job, or you do it manually, where there's people who are part of the process. And depending on what you're manufacturing, the process can be different. As a manufacturing engineer, if you're in an automated line, you make sure that you're operating the line or you're supervising the line, or there's someone who is, or in the manual process, there are people who are skilled to actually perform each step of the operation. So,
like a conveyor belt?
Like a conveyor belt, yep. Or rather, yeah, like a conveyor belt. Like when one person does something and then passes on to the next person and then the next person, and then that line goes on.
So can that be like as monotonous as conveyor belts in other industries?
That's true. So you make a good point. That was really repetitive for me. And that wasn't very new. And manufacturing is pretty much you have an established process and you follow the same process again and again.
So basically the problem solving happens at the stage of building that process.
Yes, correct. Yeah. Or to make it more efficient.
Yeah, or refining it.
Refining it.
But not executing it.
Yes.
Because that would be different people doing that.
Now the people who are in manufacturing would do other things other than that as well. Like help us as validation engineers know what they need. They are the users and they would let us know if they are using a piece of equipment, what they expect from that. So they do have other aspects inside that job. But the key role is the manufacturing process to make that, which is most of the time the same. Yeah. And it involves going into clean rooms, which I absolutely hate doing.
Yeah. You yourself go to clean rooms?
Yes. So when a manufacturing plant is being set up, or like a clean room has been set up and is ready to go, meaning when the quality control department says you need to start gowning in, which means that each of those grades, grade A, grade B, grade C, grade D rooms will require a different level of gowning. And that gowning procedure is really unforgiving.
What is that?
Because if you contact anything while you're gowning, like if that gowning procedure contacts any wall or the floor, you need to restart the gowning process again. And it involves a lot of cleaning your gloves, putting on new gloves, which can be really tiresome. Yes.
I always found washing hands process not make sense fully at home, because how does it make sense to wash your hands and then you have to close the tap that you touched with before you washed your hands, it was dirty, and then you touch things that you touched earlier, so how do you not cross-contaminate if you are like to be very strict about it?
So one example would be sterile gloves are gloves that come in like a little packet. You open them up And then they have a sleeve that's folded over, mm-hmm. which is the non-sterile part. So you touch that non-sterile part and you put it on mm-hmm. without touching the sterile part. And then you use the sterile part to touch the sterile part of the second glove without touching the non-sterile part.
Oh my God.
And then you put that on. And that's once, and you wear and remove gloves 3 or 4 times.
No.
By the time you go into grade B rooms. I think like that's just the gloves. That was the easy part for me.
That is very anal.
Then there is gowns. When you open the gown out of the packet, the outside of the gown is sterile, so you need to touch it from the inside.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if I tell you to wear your t-shirt without touching the outside of the t-shirt, that would be very annoying, wouldn't it?
You do that.
And then the gown is like a full-length gown. So it can't touch the ground. It can't touch the outside. So I need to fold the gown up from the inside and then wear it without touching the ground, which is a very unnatural process. So anyone in the quality control department who's listening to this will probably understand this. But it is a sterility requirement. It does help because what they eventually do is all manufacturing operators or anyone who enters the clean room mm-hmm. is gown qualified. So this process you do 3 times and the quality control department, they'll check various parts of your body. They'll swab your shoulders, your mask, your toes, knees, any part where there is like a worst case scenario of contamination. And if they find contamination above a certain level, then you're not gown qualified to enter the rooms.
Hmm.
Because so you're bringing in contaminants.
They do it 3 times. You just have to pass this thrice without even doing the job. You're just doing that to pass this.
To enter the rooms.
To yes. enter the rooms.
Yes.
And who does the checks? Are they...
The quality control.
Are they themselves sterile?
They also need to do it before.
So, oh my God, that's a lot of...
gowning.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of... There's a laundry service that takes in and out hundreds and hundreds of gowns every single day and brings in new sterile ones. But that's a good thing as a consumer. You would want your drugs to be made in a very sterile environment.
Yeah, I was watching the show Breaking Bad.
So you remember how Jesse and Walt wanted everything clean.
Yeah, no contamination.
Yeah.
Let me check if the camera is still rolling.
Yes. I
just want to make sure that we are... Oh. It looks like it. Cannot tell 100%, but I think so.
Is there a red dot on it?
Red dot where?
On the top. Anywhere.
No.
On the side of the camera.
I guess.
Nowhere.
I guess it wouldn't be focusing and wouldn't be working like the way it is.
Okay.
If it wasn't for. Yeah. So see, it should be good, but I need to do more. Get some more experience with it. Anyways.
Yeah.
Yeah. We were talking about manufacturing, gowning.
Gowning.
Yeah.
And then there are different doors.
Oh, please close it to the mic.
There are different doors that you enter. You enter a different room. The equipment you bring enters a different room. And then you clean that equipment inside.
How do you bring it in?
So there's a separate door. You keep it there.
Mm-hmm.
You spray it with a spore cleanse, which removes... Sporocytes. It's a sporocyte. It removes some contaminants. And then you spray it with alcohol.
Mm-hmm.
And then you keep it across the line of demarcation, which denotes the sterile side. You gown in, take it from the other side. And then from A to B, so from grade D to grade C, you need to do this. Grade C to grade B, you need to do this.
Grades meaning...
Grades are levels of sterility. Grade D being slightly less sterile environment, grade C being slightly more, grade B being even more of a sterile environment. That means its particle count in that room needs to be a certain level and less particle counts of dust, mm-hmm. microbes, things like that.
What does a regular room have in terms of sterility?
I'm not sure what a regular room has, but... So like a grade B room would need to have dust particles of 0.5 microns and less. I think about the count should, and 5 microns or less, about 3,520. Mm-hmm. That's the count for grade B rooms. And then the non-viable, that's non-viable, which means a dust particle, which is not an organism. I'm not, so if that's 3,520 for a grade B room, don't quote me on that number, but it will be much, much, much more in like this room.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So if someone finds in a single sample of a huge batch, like a contaminated, does the entire...
Yes, the entire batch gets recalled.
Just for a single vial even?
So if that's caught in the quality control step, then and if the product isn't out yet, obviously that batch is discarded.
And how big are the batches usually?
Oh, that depends.
Like $1 million worth of drug?
It could be.
Yeah.
It could be. It depends on what you're making.
Do they get partitioned, like small enough so that any of those is not as, like, I don't know, destructive to the business? Like, is that a...
Oh, as in they don't group all of them in one basket so that...
Yeah, so that...
There's like $3 million of product. I don't think any of them would be that much per piece. I highly doubt like a single vial would be that much, but the $1 million or so would be like a set of various batches. And the process of labeling and packaging is another step that comes after the manufacturing. It is considered part of the manufacturing process, but even the equipment used to label needs to be validated. One of the last things I validated in my most recent project was a label printer. And one of the things I did was printing about 500 labels or so, I think.
Wow.
And you need to make sure that they're visible, because if there is even a smudge on it, then you're essentially, you might be conveying incorrect information or unclear information to the public. Which is not acceptable. So you have a certain acceptance rate that you have. Yeah, highly regulated industry. Highly regulated. A lot of people underestimate that. Especially people who just come in to the industry. They're very surprised at how meticulous the document writing or the each and every process is. Yeah.
That probably comes from a lot of people getting hurt earlier.
Yeah, definitely. One of the things they teach us in training is case studies of previous companies that probably messed up in one aspect or the other, and due to which there's a new requirement to do things more strictly. From what I understand, the US still, the FDA requirements are still slightly more lenient, but the European requirements are even more strict. Since I haven't worked in the Europe, I can't tell what they are.
Yeah. So, can you walk me through high level process, entire process of a creation of a product from R&D to manufacturing and shipping and whatever the last stage that gets to the shelf?
So, a product development lifecycle would be, generically speaking, it would be R&D. So someone, a team or researchers, PhD students, graduate students, decide to start a startup. They have this drug product in mind. They undergo R&D tests. Then they undergo trials, typically animal trials, before they can even move on to human trials.
Wait. Earlier in the R&D, how do they know? Do they figure out they did some research early on, or they have an idea that something?
It would probably be part of the research,
yeah?
or a graduate study or a paper that XYZ inhibitor has an impact on on cancer cells.
Okay. Say. So that would be the basis.
That would be the basis.
Okay.
Now they have that product. Now they want to test it. They figured out the doses and things like that in their animal trials. Then comes the clinical trials. The clinical trials is typically the longest process.
Mm-hmm.
There's regulatory approvals to get to that stage, to get to the animal trials, to get to the clinical trials, because obviously now you're putting this in patients. So at that point itself, it needs to be pretty good. But the trials are now to make sure that that the drug is working effectively in humans. There's typically three stages, phase one, phase two, phase three of the clinical trials. And it's just a bigger and bigger batch of people who are being tested.
Mm-hmm.
Once the three phases of the clinical trials are done, the drug gets an FDA approval to be ready for use.
Mm-hmm.
And typically around the clinical trial stage is when companies look out to manufacturing facilities and see if they can find an organization that can manufacture their drug or potentially set up their own manufacturing facility.
Mm-hmm. Is the limiting factor for someone's success harder to get an FDA approval or to actually manufacture?
I think getting both is quite important. If your facility isn't ready, the FDA will audit that. And if there are significant problems, then they will point those out and not let you. They can shut you down.
Oh, so you need that to have FDA approval?
Okay. No, it's too different.
Okay.
The clinical trials are just for the drug. The FDA does audit your facility, so they can shut you down if there are significant problems in it,
mm-hmm.
so that you have no place to manufacture. Your drug can be approved because your clinical trials went fine, but your manufacturing won't be approved because your facility isn't ready.
Mm.
So both would be equally important.
Mm. Wow.
Yeah.
Have I ever told you a story about one in the supply chain of one of the big pharmaceutical companies? They realized when they went for an audit of one of their suppliers that they were providing human, what's the right scientific word for piss? samples.
Urine
samples. And that there was absolutely no proper procedure. It was just a family storing their own in their garage. And when the auditor came in, they were just in shock that there was one of their suppliers because they didn't check.
They weren't regulating that.
And then obviously they immediately stopped that. But that was one of the worst case study stories.
So they needed the urine samples?
They needed the urine samples for some reason. And
they didn't...
That was just the cheapest.
They were just get it from home. So someone just came up.
Someone set up a company to provide that as a service.
Oh my God. That seems like such a bad word. But even if they did do that, you know how when you go in for a drug test for employment or something like that, they ask you... You go to I can't remember the name of those organizations that they tell you to go inside a bathroom which has no water, no access to anything, so you can dilute the...
Really?
Yeah, so you go into this room and you just pee and you don't flush. They don't allow you to do any of that and you pee in that cup. So those are strict measures to make sure.
Yeah, I remember I had to do that for my internship. And I flushed, so they gave me a lot of water and I had to wait because I automatically I couldn't stop the habit.
Yes.
And
you heard it here first, guys. Emil flushes.
Oh God. Yeah. So back to the process. I wanted to ask the clinical trials and animal trials. There is a controversy right now, right? About, in general, about any type of animal trials.
I think that is an unavoidable step unless the people want to be tested on before being tested on the animals.
Yeah.
Just not recommended at all, I think.
In terms of ethics,
ethically questionable. Mm-hmm. But I think what they can do is probably make sure that the drug is already safe.
Yeah.
To a certain extent, at least, to be tested in animals before, which I think they are already doing.
Yeah.
Because they wouldn't let animal trials happen for anything.
So to get to animal trials, you already have to know.
You already have to know something about the drug and make sure.
How would you know that if you haven't?
Chemical composition of things.
Yeah. Okay.
I'm guessing that researchers would probably know if something is poisonous. But there are, I think, side effects and things like that it's difficult to anticipate behavior of a drug that until it interacts with the body, you can't find out.
Mm-hmm.
You
know, the huge studies and samples of like thousands of people they take.
Mm.
And when you read the drug's instructions.
Yeah.
And potential side effects, just my experience, my lifetime with reading the side effects, I became so used to ignoring them because most of the time they don't apply to me, that it just looks like a red herring. And the more I look at them, I start thinking maybe I had that experience or just, you know, try to see if like it's placebo effect.
Yeah.
But it sort of desensitized me to even respecting that the side effects can be real because...
It's usually just to protect the company because in their studies, there would have been people with those side effects and it is their duty to tell. Although those side effects probably were in a much, much smaller subset of people,
mm-hmm.
which is why... You can still see that drug into the market because the FDA did approve it. So they did deem that side effect to be
low chance
of mm-hmm. occurring. But there is still obviously a chance because all of our bodies are different and they would interact to a foreign body differently.
Yeah.
It's
not an exact science.
It's not an exact science.
Yeah.
Well, that's what they say. Medicine is not an exact science.
Yeah. In biotech, so we're talking about biotech. What are the adjacent industries, medicine related?
In biotech, adjacent would be our most closest interaction. So biotech would compass pharmaceuticals, medical devices,
mm-hmm.
Cell gene therapy, diagnostics, chemicals, reagents, a lot of different industries. And then the closest one we would probably have an interaction with would be the doctors. So healthcare.
Okay.
Yeah. That is something I haven't delved into much because I guess after you have a drug into the market, the next step would be to market it to people. Mm-hmm. And that's when people would, like a pharmaceutical sales rep would go and sell that to a doctor mm-hmm. or a hospital or at a clinic so that they would use those products.
What do you mean by selling it to a doctor?
Because a doctor probably uses a product from one company and then you have a better product. So there would be a sales rep who would go and introduce this new product which the doctor probably hasn't heard of.
Mm-hmm.
And they would tell them about the side effects and the advantages and explain it to them. And it would be their call to decide if they want to start using that or incorporating that. And the doctor will also probably have a trial period where they will introduce that drug to a new patient and be like, okay, there's this new drug that has come up. So you would hear doctors saying, oh, there's this new medication that people are working on.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it's in clinical trials.
Mm-hmm.
That's how patients participate in clinical trials and hospitals and things like that. but other times there would be like an approved drug that they could offer. That's probably the marketing aspect of things.
Yeah, is that the same doctors that you find on your in your ads, like in the uniform, in a white uniform,
just probably
looking trustworthy?
Probably an actor from Glendale.
Dentist.
Yeah.
Association approved toothpaste.
Right. Dermatologist approved. Gives me acne right after using it.
Oh God. Are those people have to be real doctors and dentists, or
the people who actually the marketing team of a company would go out to? They would have to be real doctors, obviously, and they would listen to you, or they could be a group of doctors or a hospital, or if it is a completely brand new novel idea, drug that has not been developed. I guess if it's just a paracetamol, which is like an acetaminophen, or a painkiller, there's so many out in the market. That's a difficult market to compete with. But if it's like a specific drug for that's targeting cancer cells, that's not a lot of competition.
Why is Advil more expensive than just ibuprofen?
I don't know that.
Because Advil is ibuprofen. Isn't it the same thing? It's just the brand of Advil makes it more like a tier one product?
Ibuprofen. I think ibuprofen is a type and Advil is a brand.
Yeah. It's just because a branded...
I think...
Pharmaceuticals are more expensive than off the brand, like a CVS regular.
That's true. A CVS also has ibuprofens, right?
Yeah. I was just looking recently, got some.
And if you read into detail, there's going to be different. So every
active component?
Yeah. API.
Yeah.
Active pharmaceutical ingredient.
Ingredient.
I think there's only a couple of companies that make the API for ibuprofen. I think it's because it has I'm not sure why. Might be because it has a similar composition to morphine or cocaine or something like that. Because it's all in the same organic chain. So I think they control it. They regulate it. There's only two companies, and every other company, I think, needs to buy it from them. There's something like that. I don't think therapeutics use those. So like cancer therapies and things like that. But pharmaceutical drugs, like your tablets, things like that, those APIs are manufactured by only a few companies.
Feels like a great position to be in because you're at the heart of what makes it work. Yeah. Making the API.
Yeah, that's true.
Very conspiratorial.
I know.
Switching gears a little bit. You said San Diego, San Francisco, Boston,
Philadelphia.
Outside of the US, what are the major hubs for biotech?
Switzerland, Dublin, Ireland, Netherlands.
Okay.
Those are the big ones. I come from India, so I know there is a few pharmaceutical companies in India as well. Those are pretty big. They have sites in the US as well. But I think the big ones that we hear the names of, some of them have their headquarters in Switzerland, in Switzerland, Netherlands, Ireland.
Speaking of India.
Yeah.
What do you think... is the future of biomedical or biotech industry in India?
Yeah. So I just met a fellow on the plane who was doing his biomedical engineering in India. It was surprising because I didn't even know that they were offering biomedical engineering in India. So I think it's growing, because when I was in college, I don't think people knew what bioengineering was, but now it's getting more and more popular. And I know people in the industry as well in India who are involved in like quality control, and they are aware of validation as a department. So I think it all is pretty much the same. And with the major getting more popular, mm-hmm. I think more and more people will get into these fields.
Mm-hmm.
I think India is still comparatively more into tech being IT. So biotech may not be as popular, but I think it's getting there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In your experience, a lot of the time,
yeah,
you would hear that why don't you do computer science?
Yes.
Right, in your yes. education.
Yes, that's true. I think it is a more lucrative option.
Mm-hmm.
So obviously, that does seem like something that, you know, you see your family do, or people around you do a lot. It was not something I was ever that interested in. I don't think coding was ever my forte. I initially wanted to become a doctor and go into medicine, but somewhere down the line, my plans changed. And I wanted to be more involved in engineering. And
mm-hmm.
so I got this balance of staying in the healthcare industry and being involved in engineering.
Yeah.
So I think that's why biomedical was the best choice. And yeah. I didn't have to do research. So if I was in biological sciences, then that would have been a more research intensive
yeah.
field.
Well, I respect you a lot for sticking to your guns and not just jumping on the
bandwagon
or feeling the pressure and letting
it was quite the opposite. Actually, it was the rebel it was the rebel in me that wanted to not succumb to following what everyone else was doing.
Yeah That's awesome, because I mean, clearly biotech is mega important and has a lot of cool things you can do.
I think when people enter whatever industry they're working in, they find significance in what they do.
I mean, especially healthcare, it's not the same as, like, I would say I'm entertainment. It's not as
needed.
Yeah, it's important, it's great, you can have fun with your friends after your work or study, but like you really need healthcare.
I wanted to, as a kid, always contribute to the society in some way as a doctor. Mm-hmm.
And you did your volunteering
every Sunday.
Every Sunday, right?
Mm-hmm.
At a hospital.
I worked at the burn unit in UCSD Health. Mm-hmm. And that was a good experience, but mm-hmm. some very tough things to see. And I really commend the doctors and the nurses and who work there. This is not an easy job. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Changing topics from biomedical and biotech and work. You just came back from a long trip to India, which is your homeland, and you haven't been there for a long time.
Yeah.
So what was that experience like? We started talking about it earlier. Just want to...
Very colorful. Very nice experience. I think I went back after 6 years.
Mm-hmm.
I went to a few places. Attended my brother's wedding. That was a big one. Mm-hmm. Now I have a sister-in-law. Which mm-hmm. is still weird to say. but it was nice. Yeah, very busy. Very busy. I was trying to juggle work and meeting everyone, family, after a long, long time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I think what I recommend to you is to attend an Indian wedding when you go to India.
Which is going to be yours, probably. It's
probably going to be mine. But
can you wait for my visa?
make sure you plan that accordingly.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we need a month?
Yes. So you come when there's a wedding.
Okay.
Because that is something that is like a
India at its best.
At its best, yeah.
Yeah. Before we
dive, we can crash one.
We just say relatives.
Yeah. I'm sure someone will get married in the next few months or years.
What are some of the most noticeable things that changed about India in these 6 years that you noticed?
So one thing I was telling you earlier was they started having these UPI payments in the country, which is basically a direct bank-to-bank transfer of money.
Mm-hmm.
And everything is happening digitally. I'm saying every single retailer, small shop, every single small shop mm-hmm. is now using that electronic payment method, which is a huge thing for a country with almost 2 billion people mm-hmm. because there's no notes or coins being used anymore. There's just fast payments that are happening bank to bank. And it's not like Zelle or Venmo. Those systems usually use a third party. So when I transfer money from your account to my account, it usually goes to a third party source and then goes to my account.
Mm-hmm.
But in a UPI payment, it's a direct-to-direct transfer.
Mm-hmm.
And with a large population like that, you need an efficient system like that. So the country is doing really well in terms of its progress with that. It does look very different to me now.
In terms of what?
After 6 years, there's so many... Just so many buildings and roads. Things have become much more efficient. There are still things that need improvement, but I think a lot of it has changed and become quicker. And lines are still long. That's still annoying. But I think at the rate they're going, there could be some really good improvements.
Mm-hmm. So you went to Mumbai?
I went to Mumbai and my hometown's in Indore and Ujjain. And I attended the wedding mm-hmm. in Chorat, which is mm-hmm. another town in East India.
Yeah. Mm. So did you feel a sense of connection to your extended and internal, not extended, but what's the term for the close family?
Extended family.
Yeah.
Yeah, so unfortunately, one of my granduncles, he passed away a few days after I met him in Indore. So a lot of family came to visit the house and then pay respects. So I got to meet a lot of people who mm-hmm. I was going to meet later in the week for wedding stuff.
Yeah,
but we met under different circumstances. But it was nice, I think, seeing so many people who cared about him and, you know, were there for him. It was a really warm feeling to know that you're surrounded by family. Mm-hmm. Which is something you miss in the U.S.
Yeah, being isolated
from family. But then we have you.
Yeah.
So it feels nice to come back here. It feels like home.
In terms of the wedding, what was the rituals? What
rituals?
Were the, yeah.
Oh boy.
Another podcast. Restart.
Let's make a season out of that. I think I noticed so many rituals by the end of the 2 days that I can't even count them. There were small things that you wouldn't even think are important, mm-hmm. but were really important. So I really need my family around to tell me.
Okay. So you've been whitewashed. You don't know the
rituals? Not even. No, those are not things people usually know. Unless, like, I've attended this wedding. I think the wedding before this that I attended was maybe 10 plus years ago.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not like I keep going to weddings and just get this knowledge. It's just something people acquire by going to a lot of weddings.
Yeah.
And just small, small things. I know the gist of it.
It's like a skill.
I know the gist of it, but the specifics of it. But they're amazing. Like, everything has a story. Everything has a reason. And it's just culturally so useful and meaningful. Mm. Yeah, I can't even begin to say. So the one common thing in Indian weddings is the bride and the groom take 7 rounds around the fire. Mm-hmm. There's a fire in the middle, and you take 7 rounds around it to signify that you both will be together for 7 generations. That's one thing that's very common. You see that in a lot of movies and things.
7 generations of reincarnations?
reincarnations. And
but then in every next reincarnation, you agree for 7 reincarnations.
That's true. So that keeps going. I never thought about that. See?
That's a gotcha.
Yeah. How do you know what reincarnation that is? There's no sister.
They subscribe you to the next one. Yeah, that's the next true. One.
Yeah. See, that's how they get you.
So you always have to be the same person.
And how do you know if that's the same person? So it's it's a lot of loopholes. but it's a beautiful ceremony. I think it's something to see.
Mm-hmm.
And there's so many questions I found myself asking, even though I've been in Indian weddings, and but like for you, for someone who's not been to an Indian wedding, it's probably completely brand new.
Mm-hmm.
And my brother's family, well, my family, we had a different tradition, and my sister-in-law's family, they had a slightly different tradition. So we had 2 separate traditional marriages on the same day, and we performed them both to accustom to, you know, each person's traditions.
Mm.
Yeah, so slightly different.
How so?
So they're from a different state in India, and most states in India have, even if they follow the same religion, they can have small intricacies in their, they have different languages, first of all. So that already separates a lot of things, a lot of the prayers, a lot of the things that you say,
mm-hmm.
Dances and clothing, rituals that you perform. Like in their ceremony, they don't use fire, which was surprising to us, but in our ceremony we used fire.
Yeah.
Their clothing was different. Their ceremony took less time. I think their prayers were different. But yeah.
Interesting. So how long did it take, the whole wedding?
The whole wedding. So ours, this one took 2 days, but people in India can plan it up to like 5 days.
Mm-hmm.
The more events you plan throughout the wedding. The actual wedding part took maybe, the first one took 30 minutes. The second one took like 2 hours.
Mm.
There's things around the wedding, like taking photos and meeting people and eating food.
Shopping.
Yeah. So like, imagine the church part of the wedding, you know?
Yeah.
That's like, is the wedding part. That takes like, not that long.
Yeah.
There's a shopping part, you know, a lot of costume changes.
So there's a traditional costume and then there's a modern.
Mm-hmm. So yeah. Apparently we've been wearing suits in the wedding part, mm-hmm. Of the wedding for a while. Like I've seen my dad's pictures from his wedding and he's wearing a suit.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think it's like Western influence. I think it's just, it's been happening for a while.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But they're also traditional.
There is traditional clothing. Yes. Yeah. There is traditional clothing for different events.
Mm-hmm.
And
I like it. It looks super cool.
Yeah. There's this one event in which it's just dance and music.
Mm-hmm.
That goes on usually in the night for like 3 or 4 hours.
What is the name of that clothing, traditional clothing?
Like for single? The men? For the men?
Yeah.
It's called a sherwani.
Sherwani?
Yeah.
Like a single...
Mm-hmm. It's like a single...
Piece
gown, and then you wear like sort of a pajama at the bottom.
Yeah. It looks comfortable too.
It is. It was a nice one.
Yeah.
It was good. Yeah. I didn't wear it. Only my brother wore one, as he's the groom.
Mm-hmm.
But I wore something similar, little less, you know, fancy.
Yeah.
But that's, it's like a small jacket. And then there's a kurta, which is like that one piece thing, which is what I was wearing.
Yeah.
It's a little thinner.
That's awesome.
Yeah. When you come, you'll get all of these things.
Yeah. Oh, yeah?
Yes.
We should also combine the wedding with like one of the festivals.
Oh, yes. That would be cool. Yeah, there's temples and you definitely need to see how like a atmosphere and temple is. It's something else.
Would love to.
Yeah.
What is it like?
Just the passion, you know, the religious passion in the country is something that we like. It's so exciting to see.
Yeah.
Everyone is so passionate about it and so devoted.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. To see so many people coming every day. Yeah.
I think it's really good for like feeling meaningfully fulfilled by being involved passionately about something with other people that doesn't require you to be like a prolifically successful at your career or earning some set amount of money. It just feels like that is like you figured something out with church and religion and temples where people found deeper connection.
Faith, you know?
Yeah.
Something to connect to, something to, you know, pray every day.
Mm-hmm.
Sort of like a tether to something higher than you, you know?
Yeah.
Little less selfish. Yeah. It was definitely a great experience.
Mm-hmm.
My mom's hometown is Ujjain, which has a very, very popular temple over there, very historic, thousands of years old. It's funny, like I can just say thousands of years old, and then
that's crazy.
Yeah, because there's so many temples. This the country.
That's a crazy history.
Yeah,
long, so long, way longer than U.S.
Yeah,
I mean, existed.
Yeah, exactly. Here, the history is maybe 200 years old. So it's
400 East Coast, maybe
400 years old.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was a couple of thousand years ago, and there's this statue of one of our gods, and you can just tell like how over time there have been larger and larger temples built to accommodate more and more people, and now it's the size of a couple of football stadiums. I think it's huge. Like it started off with just that, and now you can see how they built a temple around it, then they built a larger temple around it, and then now it's built around a lake.
Wow.
Or a lake was built around it, I'm not sure.
Mm-hmm.
The prime minister inaugurated the temple. Like a big deal.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And it's beautiful, beautiful architecture. Yeah.
You're growing up temple, like you would often visit temple, right?
That was the place we always went when we went back to our hometown. Mm-hmm.
What does a temple look like? Like regular standard rules of how, what's the architecture?
Usually, architecturally, it's sort of like a triangular pillar with different architectural shapes on it. And God usually sits at the underneath one of those peaks, multiple triangular peaks, and God sits under one of those peaks. You remove your shoes before you enter the temple. You wear appropriate clothing, obviously. You don't wear shorts and stuff. I think one thing I noticed different from a church was in a church, they expect you to remove a cap, right? Like if you're wearing a cap, they ask you to remove it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think in some temples, you're expected to wear something to cover your head, which I thought was interesting. Not in all temples, some.
Cover.
Some, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Cover your head.
So there's a variation between temples in the rules.
Oh, probably across cities.
Oh.
Yeah.
This is not very like homogenous. They're very...
Different cities will have different deities.
Mm-hmm.
And they will have different temples, and then different states will have their own ways of what they imagine, you know, the deity to look like.
That's so cool. And that
their architectural designs will be influenced by their people. And so, my brother said something interesting. He said, in a lot of ways, India isn't supposed to be one country, because we have different languages, we have different cultures, but we are unified as a faith, I think.
Mm-hmm. It's very fascinating.
Hmm.
And it wasn't standardized, like all that richness and variety hasn't been sort of cleared up by a dominant, I don't know, deity.
Yeah.
Like in Soviet Union, everything was so meticulously standardized to similar, same standards, same rules, that the differences exist, but the universals are very similar in terms of, oh, this is how churches look like, this is how it is, the God, the religion is the same, or no religion at certain points. And then now just the legacy of that is having, not having as much variety of that, like, would say.
It's even, nice to see.
But even language.
I think churches are still structurally different, most of them that you see, right? In Europe, if you... cathedrals and stuff. Similarly, temples are, you know, different anywhere you go see.
True.
The customs remain pretty much the same, you know. There's usually a series of shops outside. You buy a basket of flowers and offerings for God, and you remove your shoes and you enter in a huge line, usually, inside the temple. And then you give the offering, and they give it to God, and then they give it to you back.
Yeah.
Yeah, because it's been blessed by him or her.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
In terms of marriage, we mentioned earlier, I have a suspicion that there is something to arrange marriage that works better than common Western marriage. Since in my experience, my parents and their friends and my friends and their parents, a lot, it's harder to name, for me to name relationships that lasted and worked and the people didn't get divorced. It's way easier to count those than the ones that didn't work out in the long term. And then your experience was like the opposite. It's more common to stay and just be in that. So what do you think plays that part? Because I think people are people across the world. It's the same, people. Why is it the case?
I would again point to religion, maybe, you know. I think India is so religious as a country, and I think most religions condemn divorce.
So
the more religious you are, the more you are prone to follow your religion as much as possible.
Mm-hmm.
I think over the course of time, people have just become accustomed to stay with one person.
Just make it work.
I think other countries also had a little more Western influence, you know. Where was it that divorce was really high in Europe. France or something?
Not sure.
I think somewhere in Europe, I think it started off as something that was very popular and then spread to other parts of Europe.
Yeah.
But then that was normalized in Christianity, right? Mm. Even though it was condemned upon, I think in Hinduism, it's still condemned upon.
Yeah.
So much so that people are still afraid.
I mean, there is a case for if the relationship is really unhealthy and terrible.
Like obviously, people do divorce in India and stuff.
But if majority of people divorce, then it's not just, oh, I got into a bad relationship. It's something else going on as well.
Yeah, it's the
there's, I don't know, maybe it's just
societal, you know.
If maybe it's just based on feelings. If you only with a person because of feelings early on.
Yeah.
And it's not a commitment. It's like, okay, I just didn't have a decision. Mm-hmm. No matter what I feel today, we just keep going. Feelings come and go.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Divorce is also, again, a Western concept to India.
Really?
Yeah. To India, it is. I think the idea of being with another person after marrying is just like not there. Imagine if you didn't know there was an option.
Mm. And then you also don't get to know the person before you marry. Really, like you don't get to know
now them deeply, they've become like, oh, maybe you guys can go out for 3 months and then you're gonna marry, but just go out to make sure that you guys are compatible, things like that. But I think on that point, India is getting more and more influenced by the West.
Terrible.
So maybe things could change, but hopefully not. I'm seeing both sides. This visit showed me that India is getting influenced by the West and also not getting influenced by the West.
Like maintaining some...
Yeah, I mean, I noticed from 6 years ago, a lot of signs across the city were also in English, in local language and in English. This time around, everything was in the local language.
Oh.
Yeah. So... like in the writing, mm-hmm. everything, nothing in English, no temples, no tourist spots, nothing.
Really?
Yeah.
They removed it?
Yeah. So it was like being in Moscow again. Like I couldn't, this time I could understand because I speak the language, but it felt like the country was becoming more and more committed to itself and getting less and less influenced by... the West.
Yeah, that's a very interesting relationship with how to maintain your own identity as people and as place, but also benefit from
TikTok.
I was gonna say the great advances of modern global civilization.
That's true. Yes,
including TikTok,
ChatGPT. So. I mean, if you see what people wear every day, most people wear
hoodies.
Yeah, like t-shirts and pants, and those are really not Indian clothes, but but people wear them because that's the norm. So that's impossible to stop any influence, unless you cut off the country.
But it's fashionable, so
yeah. But I think it's good in terms of staying true to your roots.
Mm-hmm.
And it's good. I like this. I like that the country is developing its own identity and not trying to be influenced. I think after the British left, that was considered like the norm, right? To be like more like the Western countries. That's why our language was also sort of destroyed because of that, because people started speaking English and Hindi together. So you weren't speaking purely in Hindi.
Mm.
But whereas we should be speaking purely in Hindi.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Early on, I always had a funny... You had a funny reaction when I said your English is really good. Because technically, it's your
native
language.
Oh my God, I hate when people say that. Okay. So contrary to what I just said, yes, it is my native language, but I was raised on two first languages.
Yes.
English and Hindi. My first words were probably in English. But I learned Hindi for just as long as I learned English. Until I came to college. So
that's hilarious.
When people tell me, oh, your English is so good. I don't understand.
your feet really good.
Yeah.
Like, I've used them since I started walking. Yeah.
You walk so well.
Yeah.
Good job.
No, but yeah, it makes sense when they compare it to other foreigners, maybe. They want to give a compliment, but it doesn't always work out.
Yeah, no, I understand that. The accent makes you think that my native language is something else.
You don't have a very thick accent.
It comes out once in a while.
Same.
I just spent a month in India. It's going to come out soon.
You're talking about it like its own entity. Has a mind of its own.
Does. Yeah. It was fed for a month.
With great Indian food.
The funny thing is I go there and I try to just speak normally and people can't understand me in English. So just because I speak so fast for them. So people can't understand me here. People can't understand me there.
In this odd middle ground.
Yeah. No, I'm joking. It's only Starbucks.
Well, that's where most of the communication happens.
That's true.
With the outside world.
Yeah.
Not your colleagues, not your family, not your friends.
Yeah.
I think this is a good point to finish. There's infinite amount of things we can talk about.
Yeah. Yeah. We just cracked the surface, I think. Yes. We just spoke about a little. We haven't even talked about movies yet. That's chapter two.
Oh, yeah. Movies.
I think we can go for hours.
Yeah. Our shared experience.
Have you thought of doing a monologue on Lord of the Rings? I think we would love to hear that.
It's the greatest trilogy of all time.
Yes.
And here I will stop. Arguably.
Nothing more needs to be said.
Yes. Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to have you here. One of the early episodes in the very beginning. And then I'm sure we'll have many more. And I would love to explore more stuff.
Pleasure being here. All right.
Thank you.
So tell me more about your life. Tell me more. So tell me more.